Good morning, everyone.
Thanks very much to the John team for having me back. I'd just like to reflect back a little bit on 2017 and then talk a little bit about kind of the vision that Failte have for sustained growth in the future. Before I do, I'd just like to personally acknowledge and thank a number of people who some of whom you know, some of whom I think are kind of unsung heroes in terms of supporting the development of tourism, which of course supports the hotel sector. Firstly, and most importantly, just to acknowledge my own team, Paul Keeley, Paul Charlie, Commercial Development Director, Orla Carroll, our Product Development Director, Deborah Nolan, our Operations Director, who have been a tremendous support in terms of the work we've done over the last year. I'd also like to welcome our new Marketing and Visitor Engagement Director, Niall Tracy. I'd also like to acknowledge the great support and work of Niall Gibbons and his senior team, Mark, Siobhan and Shane, in Tourism Ireland for the support and cooperation that we've had over the last year. It's been a fantastic working experience and relationship. And I'd like to thank Isaac, Morris and Owen for their support. And I suppose particularly here today, I'd like to thank Tim from the IHF and also to congratulate and thank Joe for his support. Certainly it's been, in my experience of the team in Failte Ireland, that Joe Dolan has been a wise and balanced, a progressive and pragmatic advocate for the hotel sector, and someone who certainly enjoyed working with, looking forward to joining working with in the future. So congratulations to John, your presidency, and thanks for everything. And to welcome Michael, and say we're looking forward to really working with him going forward. I'd like to take a look back over 2017, and we've got a little bit of a video here, as we like to do, and we've got a little bit looking at some of the results, and also we're just conscious of a lot of people will interact with different parts of Failte Ireland, but it's very hard. One of the things that surprised me coming into the role was the breadth of the different things that Failte Ireland are involved in. And it's very few people that get to see the full breadth. So, short video showing you some of the results of last year, and also a flavour of some of the work that Failte does, just to give you a flavour of it. So, if we can go over here, there, Greg. Thank you. but that just gives you a little bit of the flavour of some of the breadth of what you do across the full gamut. I just like to pull out some of the highlights, some of the numbers that struck me looking back on 2017. You'll be familiar with some of these figures, but they're really big numbers in terms of and growth across the board in terms of our tourism number of visitors, amount of revenue, domestic trips, you know, all up, and overall total tourism revenue up about 4.3% to an economic value of 8.8 billion to the economy, and then that will equate to about 10,000 extra jobs coming into the sector, growing the total sector employment to about 235,000. So a hugely important sector for the Irish economy, and still one that I think most people in this room would probably have a sense that isn't appreciated for the value of the economic contribution. That's something we want to work on. I won't go through this greatly because I know Niall has got much more information on this, but I mean, we do have a changing visitor profile. The big thing is, I suppose, kind of a lower percentage of our visitors coming from the UK, a higher percentage coming from the US. I know Niall will be going into that in more detail. Some of the other things that struck me when we looked at kind of the hotel bed nights analysis when we had them for the full year was that the season does seem to be getting longer. And I know people have been talking about seasonality and regionality for some time, but it is working. When we look at, there is increases across the board, but what's really encouraging to me was we've got faster growth in January and April and September, December than we have in the May to August period. And that's showing that we are broadening out those shoulder seasons, and that's what we need to keep doing, is keep growing those shoulder seasons. Keep growing all the time, but grow the shoulder seasons faster. And in terms of regionality, we are also seeing the tourism is spreading. You know, lots of talk about kind of the boom in Dublin and stuff like that, but when we look at the growth in terms of hotel bed nights, 9% in Dublin in 2017, 11% in the rest of Ireland. So once again, great growth everywhere, but faster growth outside of Dublin. When we look at our tourism barometer results, and we look at this, the percentage of the businesses who say my business was up, my business was the same, or my business was down. And in Ireland's ancient east, which would have been, you know, one of the areas that probably struggled a little bit in the past, relatively speaking, we've got 72% of businesses, the highest number, saying our business is up. This is tremendous. So strong numbers in Dublin and the Wildland, right? As I say, I knew I was going to do this thirsty this morning. I would have drank more last night. but it's not all good news. There is a couple of kind of clouds on the horizon. Brexit is hurting the northern counties. When we look at those tourism barometer results and look at the net numbers of businesses that say they're up versus they're down, overall, for the rest of Ireland, it's 60% net saying the business is up relative to down. And it's only 45%, still very good, but less in terms of only 45% in northern counties. And once again, that carries through in terms of the prospects for 2018. And we look at that kind of Northern Ireland visitor volume, that is, you know, in terms of that is particularly important in northern counties, and that is being impacted, that is impacting on business. The other thing that I think we need to be very wary of is that, yes, our holiday makers, this is from our survey of holiday makers, when they're going home after their holidays. And, you know, overall, you know, matched and exceeded expectations. We're up in the high 90s, between 95 and 100%, which is good. So our holidays in general are happy, but there is some worrying things. Value for money has dropped from about 60 to about 50, ballpark, over the last couple of years in terms of being good value for money. So that value for money rating is beginning to deteriorate, and that's something that we really need to watch out for. And then I think really importantly is exceeded expectations has dropped from about 40 to about 30. And this is what you really want. You don't want people going home going, you know, in terms of, yeah, I had a holiday that met my expectations. You want people going home saying, I have a holiday that blew me out of the water. It was just fantastic. Because that's what makes them happy. Because that's kind of the five-star rating for Ireland. So, you know, in terms of that is certainly something. So I think there's a message in here for all of us. Everyone connected with the industry, we've got to watch value and we've got to watch the visitor experience, being that kind of the customer service excellence that these people have provided, and also all of the other elements of the visitor experience to make sure that, that we keep exceeding expectations. There were just some of the highlights of looking back on 2017. And looking forward briefly now to looking forward to the future and Failte draft vision. We're very much in the draft stage. The draft vision is about 160-page document, so get comfortable. All of these numbers give you some very headline frameworks on the elements that you're going to see in it when it comes out. Overall, in terms of what we measure ourselves in is, you know, most importantly, because this is what drives the economy's tourism revenue. Then we want to look at overseas visitor numbers, domestic visitors, employment, and tax revenue. They're all the things about how tourism contributes to the economy, and that's what we want to measure our success in within Failte. Two of the key elements of the sustainable growth model, once again, regionality and seasonality. And I'm just going to talk very briefly about those. First of all, regionality. This is the current heat map of tourism in Ireland. And obviously the red areas are where most of the activity is, yellow a bit and blue where there's relatively little tourism activity. So we've got about 70% of the activity happening in about 30% of the landmass. And that's the reality there is today. Our vision for 2028, so we look 10 years forward, is we want the map to look like this. In terms of, we want to spread that growth of tourism out of the current, leverage from the current hotspots and spread out from there. And obviously in terms of, you know, we believe there's opportunities for every county to grow the economic impact of tourism, and that's why we're signaling that everywhere is at least yellow. But obviously, you know, we think there are opportunities for some places to grow faster than others. There's just this natural higher growth potential in different areas because of the natural assets that are already there, or the built heritage that's already there, or the transport links that are there, etc. So there are regions that we think about higher potential, and in terms of there is a lot of analysis that's gone into looking at those. But we do think there's growth for everyone, but it will be at different rates in different areas. Moving on then to seasonality. The blue line is our is the current seasonality when we look across in terms of overseas holiday makers arriving into Ireland. We look at kind of the last 3 years combined is the blue line, and what we want to do is to move towards the red line. And we saw in the charts of the 2017 versus 2016, we are making progress on growing those shoulder seasons. And you know, so we do think this is very possible, and we want to keep kind of growing that. So it's not that. Don't read this and say we want to have less visitors in the summer, we want growth everywhere, we just want the percentage growth to be higher in the shoulder seasons. When we looked at the next layer of what we call kind of our strategic triangle, when we look beyond seasonality and regionality, okay, well, how are we going to do that? The next thing we're going to look at is our brand architecture. And this is effectively about, because there is such a vast array of tourism product and tourism options for people. You know, we think that one of the things that is really important and has proven to be successful is for us to organize that in a way that makes it easy for people to get their heads around and for people to understand, okay, now I know I can take all of those different tourism products and put some kind of theming, some kind of branding on it, because that makes it easier for people who are faced with an overwhelming choice of holiday destinations to choose where to come to. So, our brand architecture is we obviously have Dublin as our kind of main city and a really important tourism destination. Ireland's ancient east, Wild Atlantic Way, and the new Midlands region, which will be unveiled in terms of within weeks, not months. We're very close to launching that. And then the fifth brand is our Meeting Ireland brand, our business tourism brand. So that's really our brand architecture. The interesting bit, I suppose, is the map. And when we set out to kind of define the new Midlands region and define the new Midlands brand, we had to say, well, what's in and what's out? And we're very clear to say that, you know, in terms of we've got to be clear on, you know, in terms of for everyone on where the lines are drawn and where people sit. So effectively what this map shows is obviously Dublin's our purple, yellow's Ireland's ancient east. Green is the New Midlands region, and then the blue area is what we're calling the Wild Atlantic Ray region. And we're working through, but effectively what we're saying is for the businesses in that blue area is that we believe that the best way for in terms of brand architecture for them to grow their business is to leverage their proximity to the Wild Atlantic Way. And we'll be doing things like gateway towns, loop drives, different things like that to help support that as well, to build it out over time. So, you know, obviously, you know, if you're in North Cork, you're not on the Wild Atlantic Way, but you are in that region. We've got to remember for international visitors, the distances in Ireland are tiny. You know, the idea of kind of being 40 minutes or 30 minutes away from somewhere is nothing for an international visitor. So that's our map. And one area that's probably not as visible as possible is we've got the shaded area here along the east bank of the Shannon. Part of it, which is effectively saying there's some really, and that businesses in that area can leverage either the Ireland's ancient piece or the New Midlands, whatever works best for them. That's because there's some product there. For the Midlands region, as powerful as it can be, we need both banks of the Shannon in there, but there's some really good historical product in there, like Clonmac Noise, etc., that we need to make sure that we can leverage Ireland's ancient piece as well and build a business there. So that's our map. The next area, you won't be able to read this, but a little bit more detail. Underneath our brand architecture, we're saying, look, we have six what we call strategic imperatives, or pillars, if you like. We call them strategic imperatives. And then underneath those imperatives, we've got a range of strategic drivers. And then we have kind of key enablers, our tourism coordination structure. I'm not going to go through those in detail, but effectively, but at a very high level, and this is where the 160 pages of text comes in, but at a very high level, there's three supply side strategic imperatives that we in Fáilte Ireland need to work on to support the industry. First is about building brilliant visitor experiences. So this is through attractions, through our capital investment program. Activities is an area we really want to dial up our focus on in terms of, as Jim was saying earlier about urbanization, you know, that's a tremendous opportunity for Ireland as people who live in urban areas. You know, when they come on holidays, they can access the countryside and engage in activities such as walking, such as cycling, such as water sports, etc. That we think we can offer a really strong offering. And thirdly, then of course, is festivals and events under building visitor experience. Supporting the development of a world-class industry is something that is obviously another key thing that we want to do in Fáilte, and that's whether it's air seaports, accommodation providers, other industry providers. And then across all of the sectors, accessible tourism. And Jim spoke a little bit about that area in terms of the needs of older tourism, but I mean in terms of that area of meeting the needs of a wider variety of type of tourism is important, and it will become more and more important, and we want to support that. What isn't told of as often is this idea of supporting development of a visitor-friendly infrastructure and community. There are so many things that happen across the entire of society, across the nation, that impact on the visitor experience. But the primary driver of those is not the tourists. And therefore, you know, it's really important that we in Fáilte Ireland play a critical role in terms of collaborating with the people, the other arms of the state that are involved in developing these areas, to make sure that the visitor is brought into mind when these are being examined, you know, in terms of what is the impact of, you know, an agricultural initiative or a communications initiative or a transport initiative, making sure that the tourist voice is heard in that area and that it works to support the tourism industry as well as it possibly can. So that's areas like that. It's access to tourism assets, and they could be private or public ownership, infrastructure, transport, orientation, education, making sure that the education sector is meeting the needs as well as we can of the tourism industry, visitor information, and then wider community environment. These are all things that impact on the visitor experience. On the demand side, you know, there's three drivers for us. You know, in terms of, firstly, you know, international tourism is the is the lion's share, is kind of 65-70% of the story. So working with Tourism Ireland on marketing for overseas holidaymakers and supporting them in terms of the initiatives they have with market diversification, digital ecosystems, international publicity and business development and so that's where, you know, in terms of we work in a completely joined up way. It means kind of the work we can do from Ireland out and the work that now this does from the marketing to come together. Marketing obviously for Republic of Ireland and Northern Ireland pollinators, you know, big part of the market as well, and we need to make sure that that we're as efficient as we can. And last year we spent 3.2 million on domestic marketing campaigns to drive the shoulder seasons, and that's an important part of what we do. And then the final one is attracting international business and event visitors, which is, you know, once again a really important area in terms of high value, high spending tourists coming. That's kind of the sixth of our drivers. The final point then is just in terms of we can't do any of that by acting alone. We can only do that by acting in collaboration with industry and with all of the other arms of the state that are involved in this. So we have at the national level a tourism leadership group, and there's lots and lots of, you know, local tourism networks and visitor groups all around the country. But what we haven't had is kind of a systematic way of organizing and connecting the national down to the region. So what we're putting in place across the country is these tourism coordination groups that are looking to bring all of the arms of the state and the industry together in an appropriate way to try and advance tourism in as collaborative a way as we possibly can. This will be a key enabler for us to make the progress and have Ireland achieve its full potential in tourism going forward. So I hope that was helpful, a bit of a whistle-stop tour, but thank you very much for your time.